Excellency, Bishop Mario Vergara, Reverend Fathers, Reverend Sisters, dear brothers and sisters in Christ. The theme of this convention is written there, Storya ta. In Cebuano, Storya ta. The term means a number of things, and it depends on the intonation when you say it. When said with a high-pitched, excited tone, as in Storya ta, it is an invitation to fellowship over a bottle of beer, perhaps. So in Tagalog, it may mean kwentuhan tayo. When said in a low, serious tone, as in Storya ta, it is an invitation to a serious conversation, as when problems need to be discussed and advice is being offered. In Tagalog, it may mean mag-usap tayo. There is another version, however, when a suffix is appended to Historya and an exclamation mark is added, it becomes Historyahe. The term takes on a whole new meaning. It becomes a cynical, derisive comment about someone telling tall stories. Something similar to the American version of tell that to the Marines or in Tagalog. Isabi mo sa lelong mo. I don't know if that makes sense. One word, three nuances. Invitation to fellowship, offer of advice, cynical remark. Historya ta encompasses the whole range of human relationships. Relationships are built on trust. It begins with an invitation to fellowship. Stories told over a bottle of beer. It deepens when problems arise and advice is sought and exchanged, perhaps over a cup of coffee. It can end when trust is betrayed and cynicism sets in, perhaps with a glass of wine splashed into someone's face. The story of Historya is the human story of trust and betrayal. Jürgen Habermas makes a distinction among truth claims. For every assertion we make, we claim three things. First, that what we are saying is something that can be understood, the claim of intelligibility. That we are saying it rightly and that what we are saying is actually true. Intelligible content, normative rightness, we are saying it rightly. And trustworthiness, what we say, what we're saying is true. For every assertion we make, there are three other unsaid questions. Do you understand me? Am I saying this properly? Do you believe me? Among the three truth claims, the third seems to be the most decisive. Without trust, nothing is intelligible, nothing is proper. The Holy Father, in his message to the World Day of Communications, last January 24, 2017, chose the theme, Fear Not, It Is I. Overcoming fear, communicating hope and trust to the world in our time. As the theme suggests, the way to overcome fear is to communicate trust and hope. Perhaps because the main source of our fear is the absence of trust, the consequence of which is the diminution of hope. Trust and hope are rare commodities in our postmodern world. This is because postmodernism breaks down the grand narratives into disparate stories to the point of cutting them up into isolated units of meaning. But meaning that is not connected to a bigger context, a wider picture, ultimately becomes meaningless. Likewise, postmodernism endeavors to cut down institutions to size. The bigger ones must be brought down, since they are perceived to be structures of oppressive power. Consequently, institutions lose their credibility, freeing the discourse in centrifugal forces that threaten to tear society apart. Consider the news on the internet. With the proliferation of fake news, we need to countercheck every information with a source that is more reliable. If an information is provided by a largely unknown source, or by a source identified with a particular agenda, we need to find confirmation from the mainstream media. Not much is required by common sense. Yet not everybody has common sense. And so a lot of fake news is shared instinctively by unthinking netizens whose brain is, I think, equivalent to the size of their fingertips, driven more by prejudice by the desire to share information. Pope Francis spoke of technological progress that makes it possible for countless people to share news instantly and spread it widely. That news may be good or bad, true or false. In the face of information overload, we are called to sift through the materials we are being fed. Quoting St. John of Cassia, Pope Francis compares the human mind to a constantly grinding millstone. It is up to the miller to determine what it will grind, good wheat or worthless weeds. Our minds are always grinding, but it is up to us to choose what to feed them. Much of what is ugly in the news comes from its being detached from a wider context. The wisdom of the ages always provides the wider context because it embraces a wider reality. Of all wisdom, none bears a larger context than the gospel itself, for it spans the whole of reality, from the God who created man to the God who became human. Suffering is ugly, but taken in the context of salvific love, it becomes part of a bigger picture. Taken in the context of God's saving action, it becomes an integral part of Jesus' love for the Father and for all mankind. No fact is therefore ugly. When related to other facts in order to form a meaningful whole, even positive facts ultimately become meaningless when taken discreetly and apart from other facts that give it meaning. In order to overcome fear, you must build trust and hope, says Pope Francis. We must piece together the disparate stories of humanity which no longer seem connected and therefore no longer meaningful. The thread which holds all stories together is the gospel of Christ. It is through the lens of the gospel that all things human, even pain and suffering, failure and disappointment can be restored to their logical sequence in the code of life. In the Gospel of Jesus, says the Pope, hardship and the cross do not obstruct, but bring about God's salvation. Weakness proves stronger than any human power, and failure can be the prelude to the fulfillment of all things in love. If in the Gospel we have the words of eternal life, if in the story of Jesus we have the story that pieces all stories together, why is the Church nowadays speaking in the wilderness? If what we say is intelligible, why are we not easily understood? Is it because we are not saying it rightly, normative rightness? Or more importantly, is it because we have not been trustworthy? The other postmodern phenomenon is the cutting down to size institutions that are perceived to be structures of power. Of all institutions, the Church sticks out like a dinosaur. It is therefore a fair game to those who wish to throw the mighty from their thrones and lift up the lowly. The use of expletives in the public discourse is not only a force of habit, but an intended modus to dissolve all normative rightness Because normative rightness in discourse, or the proper way of saying things, is within the ambit of institutions. To speak politely is to submit oneself to the power of an institution. Expletives in the public forum are therefore like graffiti on the wall. They are expressions of non-conformity, the better to downsize the institutions that require propriety. That is why, in our postmodern times, the one who talks dirty in public gets the public trust. The rebels against stifling institutions always seize the popular imagination because they are like Robin Hoods who poke the pride of the mighty, the prim and the proper, the manners police. How then can the church, the prim and the proper church, convey the message of the gospel in these confusing times? By talking dirty. Some priests are only doing that. But that's out of the question. By breaking down its rules? By no means. By issuing pastoral letters? Well, you know how it is. Nobody listens. By telling stories? Perhaps. The Holy Father proposes the pedagogy of Jesus, the use of stories and parables. This use of images and metaphors to convey the quiet power of the kingdom, says Pope Francis, does not detract from its importance and urgency. Rather, it is a merciful way of making space for the listener to freely accept and appropriate that power. Parables and stories have an authority that is needless. In themselves, it matters not who tells the parables or whether they are based on true events. The universal truths they express bestow them with an inner power to lift the human spirit. If this is true of any parable, it is even more true of the parables of the Lord. For the stories of the Lord find their truth in the teller himself. The universal truths told in any inspiring story is fulfilled in the life of Jesus. This brings us back to the Storya and its nuances of meaning. Stories over a bottle of beer bring about fellowship, build trust, cement relationships. It doesn't mean that messengers of the gospel will have the smell of beer in their breath. It is enough to smell like the sheep. There are many ways to tell a story. A story put into song is more powerful than a simple narration. Music magnifies the power of a story and imprints it into the soul. Poetry, on the other hand, is like music set into words. Both render beauty not only sensible but intelligible. Film and stage bring the audience into the story. More than a spectacle, they are vehicles of experience. The power of these media is validated by the trust their protagonists gain among the masses. In fact, many actors and actresses make the transition from dramatis personae to politicians of power and influence. When fellowship deepens, counsel follows. Friendly banter silently shifts to the uncovering of pain or confusion. It is here that the gospel weaves all human stories into one meaningful whole. The wine of fellowship turns into the cup of sacrifice. Much, however, depends on the storyteller himself or herself. We must first believe the stories we tell and experience them in our lives, or our audience may give us the ultimate rebuke. Historiaje. Thank you.